Hey guys! So we are beating the heat in Costa Rica right now.
And by beating the heat, he means we're parked at a campground, sitting in the car with the air conditioning on because it's like 94 degrees out.
So yes, this video will be all about Honduras, which we spent about a month in. Our first stop in Honduras after crossing the border from El Salvador was Gracias, Lempira, cute little older colonial town.
We walked around the town one day and found a place that had, it was essentially just like a store of pickled things. And they also
had jams.
We bought a jam, and we also got homemade popsicles.
I'm still eating the jam.
Coconut popsicles. We're talking about a few different things. But it was a cute little shop and really reminded us of home. And we just sort of hung out at this really nice German-owned finca. And then the next day we headed up to Parque Nacional Silake, which was probably one of like the best park hiking experiences we've had on this trip so far. So we ended up spending two nights there?
Two nights just sort of like resting and recouping.
At the campground, the visitor center.
I was getting antsy, but it was worth it.
Yeah.
So then, yeah, we went on this like kind of epic hike. It was only a one night, like overnight sort of hike, but it was
climbed,
like a big climb.
6,000 feet?
Yeah, something like 5,000 net, 6,000 total or something crazy. And passed through cloud forests and past waterfalls, and it was really beautiful.
So beautiful.
Yeah. But then we got to camp up there with our tent, which was awesome. And then the next morning we woke up and hiked at like 3 in the morning or something. Or it should have been earlier. We kind of got a late start, but like 3 in the morning when it was pitch black, we hiked up to the actual summit, the highest point in Honduras.
Yeah.
To watch the sunrise, and we were like literally like 3 or 4 minutes late to the sunrise, but it was still really beautiful just seeing like the clouds below, basically, because it was just so high up. It was pretty epic.
We hustled. We really hustled.
Yeah,
it was so beautiful though. So beautiful. We spent another night there, so 4 nights in total in that park. And then we went to Copan Ruinas to see the ruins, which were very dry.
I mean, it's kind of amazing to think what they actually are, like how old they are. And
totally.
They have the largest collection
of hieroglyphics, I think, in the world. That stairway has something like 1,000 hieroglyphics.
Yeah, so that was really cool, like has historical value, but maybe just because it was so hot and dry and like,
and we've seen some badass ruins, so
yeah, so we, it was kind of like not the most amazing, but that's fine. Not everything can be. But it was funny because we were kind of thinking about just heading north from there, but then Liv really wanted to go back kind of the way we came, whatever, drive on the same highway for 3 hours or whatever. And so I was fighting pretty hard for not going, but it was amazing. It turned out awesome because we found this national park called Comayagua.
Yeah, but before that, we stopped in La Esperanza, which is the highest city in Honduras. The park we were just talking about is the highest point in Honduras, but the highest city is La Esperanza, a really sweet old colonial city. And it'd been raining so much, and there's always mud at all these campgrounds that we end up going to, that we decided to buy some boots, which
like the worker boots that everyone, literally all of the workers everywhere have been wearing. So.
And it seems like a very trivial thing to you guys, but they've kind of saved our lives.
Here, we can show you the boots. These boots.
This is really just so that we can remember
just
this.
Like injection molded rubber or something. They cost approximately $3 a pair.
Yeah.
And they have been insanely... I wear them almost every night.
Just like, even if it's 94 degrees out.
Because if it's not raining, in which case I'd be wearing them, then it's, you know, so buggy or walking on biting ants.
They bite like crazy. And Austin's gotten attacked many times by the ants, and the boots have saved him.
Yeah. So, we stopped in La Esperanza, bought the boots, and then continued on to Comayagua, which is a national park sort of in central Honduras, which we sort of just went there expecting to go on a cool hike, but turned out to be a pretty amazing and rewarding experience. So, I guess when we first pulled in, we went to a visitor center that actually is just sort of like a front for some sort of weird government money, I don't know.
It was like siphoning 3 or 4 years old, and no one has ever worked there.
So then some kids on a soccer field told us that we should go ask at this house up the road if we could stay with them. And so we went up the road, and this young, like, teenager guy, kid was at the house, and we asked him...
Giovanni.
We asked him if we could camp, and he was just, like, the sweetest, nicest guy.
He invited us in for coffee and gave us coffee that they had grown on their farm, and...
And at his house, they had a Princeton coffee mug,
yeah.
Which was just totally crazy.
Yeah, that was really crazy.
Very small world. So, he showed us around his property. He, like, gave us a tour of their new, like, hydroelectric plant, which is just, like, this, like, tiny turbine, but it gets water from the mountains and powers basically the whole village. Like
20 houses.
10 or 20 houses, yeah. Which is totally incredible.
But he showed us every tree, it felt like, on that farm. Gave us all sorts of fruits. All these different trees grow different fruits and vegetables, or the bark is really good in a tea because it's good for your stomach, or it's good for menstruation, or whatever. There were so many uses.
Elote. Naranjina. Mm-hmm. Malanga. Culantro. Lima. Plátano.
Yeah. Oh, and he showed us to where we could camp, and then spent like 20 minutes with his machete clearing off the area. So that we could have like a really, it was absolutely stunning. I think one of the most beautiful campsites we've had on this trip. It was just like overlooking this valley,
no
up
sorts
on the mountains.
Of services available, no
zero,
bathrooms.
Zero so services.
No sink, no shower,
it.
Which is totally fine. We loved it.
Yeah.
But it was, very beautiful.
So then the next day, the thing we had kind of come to the park for was this cool hike to a waterfall. So we did that. It was through like cloud forest, and I think the coolest part of it is that it was like just this area is just like not really on like the tourist route through Honduras. It's a little out of the way. So the hike was just stunning. I mean, it was a little bit tough because of it. It was like not a very well-maintained trail. And then, of course, the waterfall was epic. It was like 100 feet tall or something, and was just, we were all alone, and it was, a pretty magical experience.
Times I had the chance to.
But then that day or that night, we like came back and actually met the rest of the family, the Velasquez family. They're the owners of this big coffee farm in this Comayagua area. And we sort of just spent the afternoon and the evening talking with them. And they're just such amazing people. And
we planned on only staying a night. And then
we were going to leave the next day.
And then it turned into 3 and 4.
And I wonder.
Culantro de pozo, le decimos.
Oh.
Culantro de pozo. Es una...
Videos. Café.
Qué rico.
Yeah, so then I think either that night or the next morning, Liv had the idea of like, you know, hey, Ashwin, like, why don't you make like a video for them? And so we kind of brainstormed what we could do for them. We presented them with some ideas. They were really into it, obviously. It was kind of exciting, I think, for them.
And oh, I miss them.
So we spent like a couple of days, I spent shooting the video with Liv, doing some great assistance with the with the filming, and then a whole day basically editing, like scrambling to put it together, because I really wanted to show the family the finished product before we left.
Because they don't have like internet or anything out there, so there's no way he would have been able to send it to them, and then they would have been able to see it. So
yeah,
he just posted up in their kitchen.
Yeah, I just sat in their kitchen for like 12 hours and made this video, and then by sort of like the evening time when we were about to go, it was ready, and it was really awesome. We got to like show them the finished product, which ended up being kind of like a little story slash advertisement for their coffee farm. Because they actually export some of their coffee to family members they have in Minnesota, interestingly enough. And so we're really hoping that it can just sort of, you know, do a little bit to grow their business and help support them. And so far, I think our parents alone have done enough business on that website to help their numbers a little bit.
Se mira aquí, Alejandro, los granos de café.
Okay, listo.
Hola, mi nombre es José Abilio Velázquez Rodríguez. Yo soy parte de la familia Velázquez Family Coffee. En este momento nos encontramos en lo que es el Centro de Interpretación Ambiental, el Cortijo de Río Negro. Estamos ubicados a una altura de 1250 metros sobre el nivel del mar, cultivándolo con amor y todo nuestro cariño. Nuestra pequeña parcela son aproximadamente unas 30 manzanas, 15 manzanas cultivadas de café y 15 manzanas donde mantenemos bosque. Los esperamos algún día que vengan aquí a nuestra finca para que compartamos todo el proceso del cultivo de café. Gracias.
It was really, really rewarding to stay with them and to be able to give them something, because they had given us so much. They didn't, you know, we got to stay on the property for free, and
they fed us
like every meal basically.
Gave us so much fruit and veggies.
So much
from their farm. And, but anyways.
Yeah. So then we had a teary goodbye at Comayagua, and from there headed to Lago de Yehoa, which is a big lake in central Honduras. We didn't really spend much time there.
Everybody goes to see the Pulhapanzac waterfall.
That's right, yeah.
And Ashwin busted out the drone. I did some exercises up and down the stairs for like the half an hour that he was flying, and then we left.
Yeah.
And that was pretty much it. And then we headed out toward the coast because we had plans to go to Utala to go diving. So we went to Tela, mm-hmm. and then unfortunately ended up getting sick from, I think, that dinner that we went out to the night before. But we really have no idea.
Yeah, stomach bug that kind of crippled us a little bit. So
1 day hotel time turned into 3 days of time.
Yeah, it was a beautiful area, but we couldn't really enjoy much other than the bed and the bathroom.
It happens, but it hasn't happened that much on this trip. We've actually been really lucky. I feel like maybe we've had two or three serious, you know, bouts of that, but that's it.
Yeah. So after Tela, then we headed to Pico Bonito, which is a national park right, basically, in near La Ceiba, which is like the jumping off point to the islands, the Bay Islands.
They filmed an episode of Naked and Afraid in Pico Bonito National Park.
For any of you who don't know what Naked and Afraid is, it's like a little adventure show.
Everybody knows what Naked and Afraid is. It's like Survivor, but you're naked.
Yeah. We did go on a cool hike to a waterfall, and then got to swim in a river.
Saw that weird white bug.
Oh, yeah. That was weird.
Yeah, that was a weird white bug.
Pico Bonito, then we went to the Bay Islands, Utala, originally we were just going to go for a couple days to go diving, and then Liv had to exercise some extreme patience because...
Well, wait, can I tell this story?
Yeah.
Okay, so when you get off the ferry in Utala, like, every hostel on the island runs up to you and, like, pitches you their
package.
They
all have flyers with their information and stuff.
And I was like, I would heard this from all of our friends that like they kind of attack you when you get off the boat. So I like had all my stuff. I was ready to go. And as soon as we get off the ferry, I just take off walking and I ignore everybody. And I look over a couple minutes later and Ashwin's not with me anymore. And I turn around and he's like in the middle of a circle of all the hotels and the dive centers that are like trying to pitch him their idea. And I like walk back over like really confused and I was like, Ashwin, what are you doing? He's like, well, I just wanted to hear their pitch. And he has his hands are full of flyers and
I like to know my market.
It was so good.
It was so good.
So we ended up at Alton's, which was great because it was
Alton's.
outside of the main area, so it wasn't as loud or busy.
And they had really amazing prices. Like, I think they had the lowest prices we saw. So low, in fact, that I was able to just barely convince Olivia to, instead of doing like 2 days of diving, which would have been like four tanks of diving, for like $50 extra, we could make it an advanced open water certification, mm-hmm. Which would include like a night dive and deep dives and a wreck dive and all this like fun stuff. So we had a little bit of tension over that decision, but luckily, we figured that it was worth the time and the money to just like go for the certification.
There would have been one of those like blackout screens for that situation.
If we had been filming, yeah, definitely. Yeah. There's a little bit of fighting. But it turned out really cool. That island is,
yeah.
I mean...
I was happy we decided
to
do it.
The reef and everything is just really beautiful, and it's part of that sort of Central American reef system or whatever, the second largest barrier reef in the world, and tons of awesome living coral and plant and animals and stuff. But just that whole experience, really awesome. We did 7 dives over the course of 3 or 4 days or something like that.
Which was awesome, but it's exhausting.
It was tiring.
And it was so hot out there, and the no-see-ums, those little sand fleas, are just, they just destroyed me. So I think by the end there, I was kind of like ready to go. And I had the ear situation.
Oh, God.
Where like after our third dive or something, my right ear had totally clogged up. We dove again, another few dives, and it came up and my left ear was clogged. And it was super uncomfortable, really painful. And I remember hearing that there was like an ear doctor, obviously, that works on the island that helps out with people who are like having problems. And I realized I've been looking at the time, not at the camera. Apparently, I had the worst wax problem he had ever seen. I had like some seriously packed in earwax that...
It was so disgusting.
It was so gross. And I don't know if Ashwin's gonna share the photo.
I'm not gonna share the photo. It's so gross. No one wants to see that. It was disgusting, but...
But it felt so good.
after Utala, we headed back to Pico Bonito.
We left our car
at the hotel that we were staying at, and it was actually a really nice hotel that we had been camping at.
It's like a bed and breakfast.
Yeah, called Villa de Soledad. Or La Villa de Soledad. And it's a really beautiful place, and we actually ended up making a little short, like, sort of advertisement video thing for the hotel in exchange for a couple of nights there. So that was, like, super luxurious hotel time.
Really nice. Thanks, John, and
yes.
Soledad.
Yeah, gracias.
I swear we speak Spanish.
Thank you very much. No, beautiful place. Really happy that we got to stay there.
Yeah, that was very nice.
And then from there, we basically decided that it was time to leave Honduras. We had been there for almost a month. Mm-hmm. And so we headed sort of, we beelined it for the border with Nicaragua and ended up stopping actually at kind of like the midway point was in a national park called Muraya. Well, we're at hour 5 or 6 of driving today. We are trying to head to a national park.
Babe, more pep in the step. You get behind the camera.
And it's raining.
Ya comiste.
We are trying to get to the campsite, which is at the visitor center, but very far down a very rough dirt road in the rain. And so it was pouring rain, totally pouring, and we pulled up to like this way up into the mountains on this dirt road, pulled up into the like where the visitor center is, and there was Sudi, the car of Ernesto and Taisa.
What up?
Hey! So we got to hang out with them, catch up a little bit, hear their stories about Honduras for the night, and then we both sort of had other plans and split up from there. But it's been fun, yeah. That was the second of maybe 4 times in the last couple of months that we've randomly run into Tyson Ernesto in, like, totally crazy small places. So the timing is kind of incredible.
Totally.
But
hope it happens again soon, guys.
Yeah. And then, so from Mariah, we just headed right into Nicaragua, and that will be the subject of the next entry. But before we go, we thought we'd have a little bit of a change of pace, and based on some suggestions from Diane, thanks Diane, we thought we'd have a little bit of a summary section at the end here with some best of moments kind of thing. So, Liv, do you want to kick it off?
Okay. My highlight of Honduras was definitely our stay with the Velasquez family. They were so warm and welcoming, and they didn't even know us. We were total strangers. They were total strangers. And just being around their love of their land and their love for their family members and their love for their workers, and there was just a lot of love floating around there. So it was nice to be, and it was nice to be with a family, you know, for a little while. How about you? What was yours?
Well, that was also my favorite part of Honduras, but I think that just went to show that Honduras is, like, so different than what you see in the news. Like, and, you know, many times on this trip we would be meeting people along the road, and they would tell us, like, oh, have you enjoyed Honduras? Like, and then we would say, of course, yeah, it's beautiful, we've loved it. And say, oh, you know, like, that's so awesome, like, please, like, share your good experiences with your friends back home. These people know that in the U.S. all we hear is that the capital is, like, the worst city in the world according to every news media outlet. And so you hear this and you're scared to go. We didn't even know if we would pass through Honduras super quick or not, and it turned out to be, like we said, like, one of the, I think, best, generally the best countries we visited.
It was my favorite country so far.
Yeah,
for
so
sure.
Do you have a favorite meal from Honduras?
I think just, like, desayuno típico is my fave. It's like typical breakfast.
Very simple.
Very simple, very delicious. I know you have one, though.
My favorite meal, definitely, was a bean soup that Bertilia Velasquez made us during our time in Comayagua. It was like basically desayuno típico in a bowl.
Yeah. There was egg in there too.
There was egg.
Yeah,
so it was
remember?
Basically the same, but just really, really tasty. Let's see, what was the most surprising thing? we experienced. Biggest surprise.
I don't know. Do you have an answer for that one? Okay, that's on the next one. Well, it's getting really hot in the car, even with the AC, and I can't turn the AC up higher because Ashma won't let me because it makes the video too loud. So we gotta go. This is our snack bag, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
It just goes on and on.
All right, so we hope you enjoyed the Honduras update. Honduras was, as you could tell, one of our favorite places that we've been so far. And so we hope we got that message across. But the next video update will be on Nicaragua, which hopefully will come soon because we are already in Costa Rica, in fact. So with that, this is Liv. I'm Ashra, and these are Politos. And we will see you later.
Peace.
Bye.